Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Witch's Inn by Danielle Garrett. Narrated by Amanda Ronconi. Chapter 1. Ravens are lovely birds, but in my experience, when one shows up on your windowsill with a letter dangling from its beak, you're in for a whole cauldron of trouble. The last time a raven brought me a letter, it kicked off a roller coaster 24-hour period where I ended up imprisoned and then exiled. It all worked out for the best, but my impression of the creatures was burned forever into my mind. So, when I padded downstairs to the kitchen, blinking to clear my eyes of sleep one morning in early June, I nearly jumped out of my skin at the sight of a glossy feathered bird sitting outside the window above the sink. Oh, unholy batwings! The raven, undeterred by my loud cursing, tapped its beak gently against the window. Cringing, I crept across the kitchen, unlatched the window, and pushed it open. The raven lifted its head and opened its beak just enough to release its hold on the red ribbon wrapped around the scroll of parchment. "Thank you," I said to the bird. "One second." I set the tube of paper on the counter beside the sink and took a sidestep to open the wooden bread box. A loaf of whole grain bread sat inside, fresh from the bakery the afternoon before. I tore off a small chunk and offered it to the raven. Happily, the bird accepted the gift, ducked its head low in thanks, and then took to the sky, melting into the lifting darkness. A swooping sense of dread swept through my stomach as I took my eyes off the bird and glanced at the scroll. The sender had sealed it with the Haven crest. Official business. After years spent living as an outcast in Haven society, it was hard for me to accept that there might be some bit of pleasant news in an official letter. "You're being ridiculous," I chided myself as I snatched the parchment off the counter and broke the wax seal. I wasn't an outcast anymore, some kind of shadow lurking in the fringes of the Haven world. That was the past. Now, I was a licensed potions master, a businesswoman, and a successful one at that. My potions shop, Starfire Apothecary, was a smash hit in the Seattle Haven. Sales were not only steady, they were increasing, month after month. I'd hired 2 part-time employees to work alongside my apprentice, Harmony, and me. On top of that, my fiancé and I had recently purchased our first home and converted part of it into an inn meant to cater to paranormal tourists. For all I knew, the official letter in my hands was congratulations, or an invitation to some kind of summit. Still, I couldn't help but wince a little as I unrolled the parchment. Behind me, the kitchen door creaked slightly as it opened, and a pair of bare feet slapped against the tile floor.
"Good morning, gorgeous,"
a sleepy voice mumbled. Turning, I held up the letter. "We're about to see if it's a good morning."
"What's that?"
Adam St. James, my fiancé, asked. His thick dark hair was mussed from sleep, and his dark brown eyes looked like he would happily climb back into bed for a few more hours if his schedule permitted. As it was, we both had to hustle up and get to our respective workplaces. His at the Supernatural Protection Agency building in the Seattle Haven, mine at the apothecary. "Letter from the Haven," I replied. "A raven just dropped it off a minute ago." Adam grumbled something and dragged one hand through his hair, only making it stick out all the more. I cleared my throat and read aloud. "Dear Mr. St. James and Ms. Bolt, we have received your application to join the approved list of Haven Hospitality Certified Accommodations in the Pacific Northwest. To complete your certification, you must submit 25 individual letters of recommendation from guests. Once received, we will complete the processing of your application and have your establishment, the Beechwood Inn, added to our esteemed directory. Your assigned liaison, Pierre Ansel, will work with you through the remainder of the process. Please forward any further questions to him. Kindest regards, Vivian Shears, Haven Hospitality Committee." Dropping the letter to the counter, I bunched my fists together and pressed them into my cheeks to keep from screaming.
Ugh! Sounds like we're stuck with Le Professeur for the long haul,
Adam replied, lending a terrible impression of a French accent to the last half of the statement. He was referring to Pierre Ansel, our so-called liaison, an uppity Frenchman who could likely find fault with the Mona Lisa. He'd originally been appointed to oversee the renovations of the Beechwood Manor when its former owner and our former landlady, Posey, agreed to sell the historic home to the Supernatural Protection Agency. The SPA hired Pierre to kick out its current tenants, a.k.a. us, and turn the building into an inn, the profits from which would go to the agency. Things took a dramatic turn for the south when Pierre showed up with a sledgehammer-happy crew of construction workers. When the walls came down, Posey threw an epic ghost fit and nearly leveled the place. Posey rescinded her agreement with the SPA, prompting Adam and me to swoop in and make an offer to buy the property ourselves. What we hadn't realized at the time of signing was that the SPA kept some of their power over the project. They didn't own the property, but we would still need to work in partnership with them if we wanted to keep our current roommates slash tenants and help in security screenings for future guests. As part of the deal, they saddled us with Pierre to help us work through the rest of the renovations and paperwork. So far, he'd provided us with mountains of feedback, none of it positive, and generally proved to be a pain in the rump. 3 days ago, we'd checked off the last task on his mile-long preparation spreadsheet and assumed we'd finally be able to bid him au revoir. Or not. How do they expect us to get 25 letters of recommendation if they won't include us in any promotional materials until we do? This is a total chicken and egg situation, I scoffed, jerking the glass carafe from the coffee machine. I stalked back to the sink and flipped on the faucet. What do they think Pierre will do for us? Does he have some sort of secret list of supernaturals dying to visit Beechwood Harbor?
We'll figure something out,
Adam said, his back to me as he raided the freezer and fridge. He took a step back, his arms full of food, and let the doors fall closed. What in the other world are you making? I asked, giving him a once-over as the carafe filled. He dumped his collection on the counter. A box of freezer waffles, two different glass jars of jam, and syrup.
Waffles. You want some? I think we have another box in there.
I smiled as I rolled my eyes. No thanks, I'm good. Adam was a shifter, therefore blessed with an insane metabolism that allowed him to eat near endlessly and never gain an ounce.
We're opening a bed and breakfast after all, he teased, flashing a half-cocked smile.
Yeah, well, I think we'll leave the breakfast part to Matilda down at the bakery. A platter of Eggos isn't likely to get us the glowing reviews the committee is apparently expecting. I sighed and tapped the brew setting on the coffee machine. Although I suppose the real battle I should worry about is keeping you from scarfing all the pastries before the guests get a chance at them. Adam chuckled as he slid 4 frozen waffles into the slots on our brand new toaster.
I trust that you'll order extras.
He was right. I had. The mother-daughter duo who ran the local bakery knew all about Adam's enormous sweet tooth and promised to include something for him in each morning delivery. As the coffee brewed, my gaze slid to the clock on the wall above the kitchen door. Nearly 5:00. No wonder I felt ready for bed. I hadn't even gotten to bed before 11:30 the night before, and even then I'd tossed and turned for some time, my mind running through our endless task list that never seemed to get any shorter no matter how busy my days were. Running one business while trying to open a second was draining the life right out of me. Since buying the manor 3 months ago, we'd spend every spare moment working on getting it ready for guests. We worked around our full-time jobs, squeezing most of the work into the evenings and weekends. The big projects were finished. With the help of a telekinetic witch, we completely transformed the layout of the manor, adding suites on both floors, expanding the kitchen, study, sitting room, and attic. Almost every room in the large manor had undergone some changes. Still, there were the cleaning and landscaping tasks to manage. Adam was working on building a website for the inn, even though most haven-dwelling supernaturals didn't bother much with technology. Our goal was to cater to both those who lived in the havens and those outside. Adam assured me a website was the key to reaching potential guests. I just had to hang in there a few more weeks. Once we started getting guests regularly, Adam would cut back on his hours in the office and spend more time working from the inn. All we needed was that stamp of approval from the Haven Hospitality Committee. Without it, things would be a little tricky. Supernaturals are wary about interacting with the human world. If traveling outside a haven, the first thing one would want to see is that HHC recommendation. I don't even think I know 25 people, I said, pausing the coffee machine long enough to pour a mug for myself. At least not supernaturals who don't already live here. Kind of goes with the whole small-town living thing. Adam's waffles popped, and he began smothering them in various toppings. Jam, syrup, peanut butter, whipped cream. He eventually crafted a tower of 8 of them, all stacked together like a layered cake. I wonder if Evie and Harmony count. Evangeline Loren and Harmony Winters were still in residence at the manor, though they'd changed rooms, opting to take 2 rooms at the end of the hall on the 2nd floor with a Jack and Jill bathroom in between. It worked well, leaving us with 4 suites for guests, all with their own bathroom. The common areas were all open to guests, save the sitting room, which we'd agreed to keep for residents only. The 2 wooden doors were spelled, with threshold wards that would allow us entrance while keeping out the guests. The sitting room was set up to accommodate us, complete with a large flat-screen TV above the fireplace, a huge bookshelf on the back wall, and a square table with 4 chairs, ideal for studying, doing puzzles, playing board games, or reading. There was also a ping-pong table positioned in front of the triple-paned picture window. An addition made only after Adam and Harmony won a heated game of rock-paper-scissors versus Evangeline and me. I doubt it, I replied, shaking my head. They're tenants, not guests. I doubt we'd be able to slip that by the HHC. Adam carried his creation to the table and sat in his usual seat at the end closest to the door. Guess we'll have to wait and see what Le Professeur thinks. What time is he coming tonight? 7, I replied, leaning back against the counter. I took a sip of the hot coffee. I'll try to be back by 5:30. Adam nodded, swallowing a bite. All right, me too. We'll figure this out, gorgeous. We haven't come this far to turn back now. Smiling, I set my coffee mug aside and crossed the kitchen to drop a kiss to his whipped cream-flavored lips. Thanks for keeping me sane. Semi-sane, I'd say, he replied, grinning at me. I laughed and swatted him on the shoulder. I'm going to grab a shower. Will you feed Bootsy when he wanders down?
Yeah,
Adam agreed, before adding, spoiled cat. Still laughing, I reached out to push open the swinging door when it came flying back at me instead. I jumped back to avoid getting smacked in the face, and Evangeline swept into the kitchen, stopping just short of crashing into me.
Oh, Holly! Sorry!
She blinked, realizing she'd almost bowled me over.
Didn't know you were there.
That's all right, I said, catching the open door before it swung back at her. She wore a long-sleeved black shirt, the kind with holes meant for thumbs to slip through, and a pair of cerulean blue leggings. Her raven hair was tied up in a topknot that defied gravity as her Rapunzel-like tresses created a bun about the size of a volleyball. I couldn't decide if she used some kind of spell to keep it from flopping over or if it was just an unholy amount of hairspray. What's up? Did you just get off the spin bike? After Adam and Harmony won their ping-pong table, Evangeline and I embraced the clutter and ordered a spin bike. If you can't beat 'em, join 'em. I'd used the bike twice in the 6 weeks since it had arrived, but Evangeline was a true devotee and climbed aboard several times a week. Which, considering I'd been living off pastries and lattes for much of the last 3 months, I probably needed to change.
I'm about to get on, she replied. I just need a little coffee first. I didn't sleep at all last night, and my to-do list is about a mile long today.
Anything I can help with? I asked.
Not really, she replied. But thanks anyway. I'm just all spun up because of Teddy's visit.
I smacked my forehead. Oh, I'd almost forgotten. He's coming tomorrow, right? Evangeline crossed the kitchen and poured herself a cup of coffee.
He should be here by noon.
I'm so glad he was able to come visit. It's been a while. I flashed Evangeline a knowing smile. Are you in full-on butterflies mode right now? Cupping her mug, she chewed at the corner of her lower lip.
More nauseated than butterflies.
My smile fell. Oh, no.
I'm excited to see him, of course,
Evangeline said, before exhaling and dropping into one of the wood chairs encircling the farmhouse-style dining table.
I guess I'm just nervous because it's the first time in a long time, maybe ever, that I've really wanted something to work. I haven't seriously dated anyone since moving here. And even when I was back in Los Angeles, all of my relationships were shallow and temporary. Distractions, mostly. But Teddy isn't a distraction. I don't want him to be another flash-in-the-pan flirtation. I think I'm ready for the next step.
And you don't think Teddy is on the same page? I asked gently. It didn't square up with my impression of Teddy. Anyone with eyes could see he was a smitten kitten for Evangeline. But then I only saw the outside layers of their relationship. Maybe there was something I'd missed. A corner of Evangeline's mouth curved up into a hapless smile.
That's the problem. I don't know.
She looked up at me and then to Adam.
I mean, you two have this whole relationship thing figured out. What's the secret? How did you know when the other person was ready to settle down and get serious?
Adam slid me a half-cocked grin before answering.
Well, see, this one was pretty squirrely. So one day I had to pin her down and say, "Woman, it's time to make up your mind. Are you in or out?"
Laughing, I rolled my eyes. Yeah, that's totally how I remember it, too. Adam chuckled and looped an arm around my waist, pulling me to his side.
I knew from the minute you walked in the door of this house I was in trouble, he said, looking up at me, his dark brown eyes shining. You thought I was this major player with all these women falling at my feet, and I had to work overtime to prove to you I wasn't looking for another game with you.
I leaned down and kissed him.
Okay, well, this isn't helping, Evangeline interjected. Teddy is about as far from player status as one can get.
I stifled a laugh and slid into the chair beside Adam. Honestly, I started, I think you just need to talk to him. Maybe not the second he gets here, but maybe over dinner or something. Tell him how you feel and see what he says. You're right. Teddy isn't a player, and I don't think he's interested in games or stringing you along. Evangeline huffed.
I just wish he would be the one to bring it up.
Adam smiled.
Evie, don't take this the wrong way, but I think you kind of terrify the man.
Evangeline blinked.
What's that supposed to mean?
Adam laughed softly.
I don't mean it in a bad way. I just mean that you can intimidate a lot of guys, so you might have to be the one to raise the conversation. If you let him know where you stand, that will give him the space to tell you where he's at.
I nodded in agreement. I think Adam is right. You and Teddy have a history. I'm not saying you broke his heart before, at least not intentionally, but he might be a little gun-shy about making some big declaration of love. You might have to read the smaller clues.
Evangeline took that in, her brows knitting together as she stared down into her mug.
Try not to stress, I told her. Just enjoy the time together and see how things unfold. She offered me a smile, but a lingering worry line remained in place.
Hey, you think we can get Teddy to fill out a recommendation after his stay? I mean, he's not technically an in guest, but the HHC doesn't have to know that,
Adam teased. I don't think we should start badgering our friends for help, I replied, frowning at the idea.
Who's badgering? Adam asked. Teddy is staying here at the inn. It fits the requirements.
You just want me to order some pastries, I said, shooting him a grin. Adam smiled as he hitched a shoulder.
Well, you know, we want him to feel welcome.
What are you two talking about? HHC recommendations?
Evangeline asked. I held up the letter and briefly explained.
I've never heard of the HHC before, Evangeline said when I finished.
Think of it as some kind of supernatural AAA,
Adam replied. Evangeline looked at me, her face blank. The former starlet had spent her entire life in the Haven world. She likely did not understand what AAA was or how it worked. Basically, the HHC gives our business, the inn, a stamp of approval, to have the inn listed in the travel brochures used in the havens. Whenever a supernatural wants to travel outside the havens, into the human world, they pick up a magazine or call a travel agent, right? Evangeline nodded. Without it, well, the inn will be dead in the water. Adam frowned as he dunked a cracker into the jar of peanut butter. At least until we get the haven world onto the interwebs, which at this rate will take another century. The supernatural communities, tucked away in the secret cities known as havens, didn't have access to human technology, at least not from the last couple of decades. The magical communities used magic, not technology, to keep their cities turning, and most citizens were content to live without the internet and the advances it provided. My fiancé, Adam St. James, was a tech junkie, despite being raised in a haven from birth. Somewhere in his teen years, he'd fallen in love with computers. Since then, he'd worked to get more supernaturals to come over to the so-called dark side, with the promise of cookies, naturally. But it was an uphill battle. Recently, he'd taken a full-time job with the Supernatural Protection Agency to see if there was a way the law enforcement agency could take advantage of technology to fight supernatural crime, while also providing the bridge to the haven communities at large for their citizens to enjoy. So far, though, he'd run into roadblock after roadblock, and when he made it through those, realized the entire road led to a dead end, and wound up back at the starting line. Most supernaturals live in the havens and rely on haven-approved resources for things like travel plans, especially when considering going into the human world, which most still see as unnecessary. I exhaled and snagged a marshmallow from the bag. So, for the foreseeable future, if we have any shot at making this entire thing work, we need that stamp of approval, which means we need Pierre. Adam grumbled something impolite under his breath. Got it, Evangeline said with a pert nod. Well, in that case, I'm sure Teddy wouldn't mind filling one of the cards out. She grinned. Should I put a mint on his pillow every night? I laughed. Go for it, but it will have to come out of your own pocket. The inn budget is officially tapped out. We'd spaced the purchases out over a handful of months, postponing our grand opening until the summer. But even then, it all added up. Every guest room got fresh linens, towels, and fluffy spa robes and slippers. Adam convinced me to put a flat-screen TV in each of the suites, and we'd redone the flower beds in front of the manor, sprucing up the landscaping with 2 truckloads of flowers and plants. We'd also given the exterior of the home a fresh coat of dove gray paint with navy on the trim and shutters. It looked amazing, but left our shared bank account looking a little not so awesome. When are the first guests coming? Evangeline asked. I thought it was this coming weekend. My skin prickled as my nerves shook and quivered. It is. We have one family coming on Saturday morning. They'll be here for 3 days, Adam added. They're friends of my parents. Or family friends, I guess. When my parents told them what Holly and I were doing, they called and made their reservation. They live in California now, but they're from Boston originally. As excited as I was for our first guests, I wasn't ecstatic at the prospect of them being friends of Adam's parents. I'd only met Adam's parents one time, toward the beginning of our relationship, and the visit hadn't gone according to any of the plans we'd made. It's not ideal to have your future in-laws' first impressions of you involve getting dragged away in handcuffs. Live and learn. So, when Adam told me our first guests were longtime friends of his parents, who'd known him since he was running around in diapers, I knew that every detail of our venture would go straight back to Bella and Mort, which was enough to make me break out in anxiety hives. I just knew I would trip over the corner of a rug or spill salsa down the front of myself in front of Adam's parents' friends. Months ago, back in February, when Adam and I first started talking about taking over the inn, the entire idea sounded so novel and exciting. But as the weeks ticked by, my anxiety started mounting, unable to shake off the feeling that we'd bitten off way more than we could chew. We'd done everything we could to prepare, and now it was time for all the planning and prep work to pay off. You guys are ready, Evangeline said, beaming.
The place looks amazing. I swear it's been, what, 4 months since that renovation witch came in here and went all fairy godmother? I still do a double take when I come into this kitchen. I smiled. I couldn't help it. The place looked like something out of a magazine. Evangeline hopped up from her chair, her mood buoyed. Thanks for listening, you guys. If there's anything you need to get ready for the guests, let me know. But honestly, I think you'll be great. Chapter 2. Pierre Ansel arrived promptly at 7 o'clock that evening, clipboard in hand. As soon as I opened the front door, I wished I could close it again. The man reeked of arrogance and didn't have a personable bone in his scrawny little body. It was a marvel he could move at all, with his slacks pressed to within an inch of their life. But he swept into the manor like he owned the place, not waiting for an invitation inside, and marched straight for the formal living room. Adam and I followed, jaws clenched. Pierre waved a spindly hand at the couch, offered a dry cough, and then perched himself on the edge of one of the wing-back chairs flanking the fireplace. "Good evening, Pierre," I said, my tone dry. "Nice weather we're having today, don't you think?" Pierre's upper lip twitched.
"Indeed," he replied,
swinging one leg over the opposite knee with an almost mechanical jerk.
"Now shall we get to business? I assume you received the correspondence from the Haven Hospitality Committee?"
"We did," I replied, offering a curt nod. "We have to get 25 recommendations from guests before they will give us our accreditation or add us to any directories."
"That is correct,"
Pierre sniffed, his accent thick.
"After all, the committee cannot have any common riffraff filling up their books."
My fingernails dug into the fleshy part of my palms. "How are we supposed to get 25 recommendations when we can't advertise to anyone in the Havens? No one knows we exist."
"This is a tourist town, is it not?"
Pierre asked, feigning ignorance. "Yes, for humans," I replied. "So unless the agency is interested in their opinion, which I doubt, we're kind of low on foot traffic." Pierre tilted his head, a sharp smile twisting his thin lips.
"Perhaps I could make some phone calls, but then the customers I can reach are not likely going to be impressed parking in the street."
I groaned and dropped my head back against the couch. "I can't do this. Not again." Adam placed a hand on mine.
"Listen, we already told you we don't have the budget for a bigger driveway. You are not going to change our minds unless you want to fork over some cash and pay for it yourself."
Pierre made a tut-tut sound.
"Such a shame. All of this work, and for what? Oh well, I tried my best."
Standing, he tucked the clipboard under one arm.
"I wish you the best. Call me when you are ready to submit the reviews for the committee, and I will assist you with the paperwork."
"What?" Adam roared, surging to his feet.
"That's it? You're leaving?"
I jumped up beside him and planted my fists on my hips. "We've listened to every other asinine suggestion you've made. Changed the drapes, moved the furniture, ripped apart the front yard, painted the shutters the color you thought would look best. We've dealt with months of these pointless meetings, listening to you prattle on and on about all the things we supposedly got wrong, and now you're just washing your hands of the entire project?"
"I did not say that,"
Pierre replied, his smile polite even as his eyes glittered with heat.
"We have reached an impasse. If you will not take my advice, then I have nothing more to offer to you."
"This is your job," Adam fired back. "You honestly expect us to believe that your super secret clients would refuse to stay here because they'd have to park on the street?"
Pierre scoffed.
"It's not only the driveway. There is also the roof. Imagine the horror if one of my esteemed clients were to get rained upon in their very beds at night."
I crossed my arms, if only to keep from lashing out with my magic. "We can't afford to get the roof fixed right now. The inspector said it will hold for at least another 2 years. No one is getting rained on while they sleep." Adam flexed his jaw as he stared at Pierre.
"What is this really about?" Are you just so controlling that you won't help us unless we roll over and do every single thing you say?
I have certain standards to uphold,
Pierre insisted, haughtiness dripping from the words.
If you refuse to meet them, I cannot, in good conscience, arrange for any guests to stay here.
Fine, I snapped. Then tell us where else we can find guests without the hospitality committee's help. If you're such a whiz at all this, you must have an idea. Going after Pierre's experience seemed to be the only point of attack we had left. For a moment, I thought he would take the bait. Then, a steely glaze fell over his eyes and he pivoted on his heels.
I have done all I can. Call me when you are ready to file the paperwork, or if you change your mind about the improvements I have proposed. Good night.
With that, he marched his starched backside out of the room, and moments later, the front door shut with an emphasized thump. Adam swore and raked his hands through his thick hair.
Well, that was a disaster, I muttered.
Adam dropped his hands to his side and exhaled.
I need a drink.
Assuming you don't mean coffee, I replied with a laugh.
Only if it has a double shot of bourbon in it.
McNally's was the best place in town to get a drink, especially as it always came with a side of fries when Adam was involved. The pub was usually busy, as they offered a sit-down restaurant for families until 10. We'd just entered the beginning of June, and tourist season was already in full swing, leaving not a table unspoken for. Adam headed to the bar to order a drink while we waited, and I stayed near the hostess station to wait for our name to be called. The doors opened, and I stepped to the side to allow the incoming patrons some room, only to realize the woman stepping inside was my best friend, Cassie Lincoln. Hey, Cass, I exclaimed. Cassie wore a fitted black t-shirt bearing the Siren Song logo of the coffee shop she managed. The shirt stretched over her tiny baby bump, and on either side, there was a blue handprint painted on the fabric. 2 weekends ago, Cassie and her husband, Chief of Police Jeffrey Lincoln, had hosted a gender reveal barbecue at their house. Kira, Cassie's younger sister, had been the only one to know the gender for weeks. And on the day of the party, she'd blindfolded Chief and Cassie, painted their hands, and applied them to the t-shirt. When she removed the blindfold, they'd both gasped and hugged, marveling at the painted prints and the blue paint marking their hands. Even the chief had to wipe away a few stray tears.
Hey, Holly!
Cassie squealed, gathering me in for a quick hug. Chief and I exchanged a friendly greeting. Adam's around here somewhere, I said, thumbing over my shoulder toward the central bar. It's been one of those days.
I hear ya,
Cassie sighed, placing one hand on her belly.
The shop was nuts all day.
The door opened again, and Kira, Cassie's younger sister, crowded into the foyer, prompting another round of greetings. We made small talk about the coffee shop and the new mural being painted on the wall of the public restrooms down by the beach access point. The artist was apparently one of Kira's former classmates. And after a few minutes, the hostess tapped me on the shoulder and let me know a table had opened up. I waved goodbye to the trio and met Adam at a table for two near the kitchen. His menu lay on the edge of the table. I doubted he'd even cracked it open. We ate at McNally's often enough that we had the entire thing committed to memory. Chief Cass and Kira are here, I explained, sliding onto the chair opposite his. Adam craned around and offered them a wave, just as the hostess approached to lead them to their booth on the other side of the pub. He exhaled when he turned back around in his chair and reached for the tumbler of dark amber liquid. He hadn't been kidding about the bourbon. We'll figure this out, I told him. We haven't come all this way just to give up. We've got your parents' friends coming, so that's two.
Great, so we just need to find 23 others, preferably before our next mortgage payment is due.
He tossed back the rest of the bourbon. A knot in the bottom of my stomach twisted a little tighter. Well, what about Lacey? She's got some sway in the East Court. Maybe she could host some kind of meeting or retreat. Adam smiled.
Oh, sure. A beach town in summer should attract a pack of sun-allergic vamps in droves. Maybe if we had some kind of nightlife, but let's face it, Beechwood isn't exactly rocking when the sun goes down.
Our server approached and we put in our order. Adam only ordered one entree, which was a bad sign. When even he lost his appetite, I knew things were careening toward hopeless. Lacey found things to do around town after dark, I reminded him, once our server departed. Adam shrugged.
Maybe, but do we really want to try to appease a pack of hoity-toity court vamps for a week? It's not like they're famous for being agreeable and easy to work with. For all we know, they'd leave us negative reviews for serving off-label faux blood.
I slumped back in my chair. He was right. Vamps, especially court vamps, were a persnickety bunch.
I also think Merrill might have a thing or two to say about the idea,
Adam added, his voice hushed. I swallowed hard. A few months ago, we'd had a nasty run-in with a vampire, and according to Merrill Miller, junior SPA agent, the trouble was only just beginning. There was a sector of vampires who resented being shoved into the shadows, and were taking their discontentment out on an unsuspecting public in big cities. Cities like Seattle. Lacey wasn't dangerous. Well, at least not in that way. But who knew what kind of vampires she surrounded herself with? She was, after all, on par with vampire royalty, and a lot of those old-timers still like to reminisce about the way things used to be. Adam was staring at me, waiting for a decision. I shook my head once and cleared my throat. She's probably busy. I don't want to bother her. Besides, you know, the two of you can't resist tearing into each other, and I can't imagine that going well in front of a big posse of her fanged friends. Something flickered in Adam's eyes, though I wasn't sure if it was amusement or mischief. Maybe both. After a moment, he reached for his water glass.
What about your Aunt Bethany? Seems like with a wedding coming up, it might be time to extend an olive branch.
The question was casual enough and would appear benign to anyone who was watching from the outside. But the mere mention of my aunt sent my heart into a chaotic little spiral of anxiety. I squirmed in my seat and picked at the corner of the paper napkin encasing my silverware. I don't think she wants to hear from me.
Ollie, Adam said gently. It's been a long time. Maybe it's time to let bygones be bygones.
I set my chin. She wasn't there for me when I was shivering in an SPA prison cell, heartbroken and betrayed. She wasn't there for any of my hearings before the Haven Council. Someone with her clout could have made for a nice ally, but she didn't bother showing up. I shook my head again, this time a little harder. No, she made her feelings about me quite clear. Adam considered me for a long moment, then ducked his chin, dropping it.
All right. Well, what about Anastasia? Surely if there is someone who could fill our reservation books, it would be her, right? I blinked.
Of course. It was so obvious. How had I missed it? Bat wings, that's perfect. I dug into my purse and pulled out a small notepad. I tugged free the ballpoint pen clipped to the front cover and removed its cap, my mind whirling. We could have her put together some kind of summer retreat. Adam tilted his head.
Like what? Supernatural summer camp?
I bowled ahead, undeterred by the note of skepticism in his voice.
She knows all the movers and shakers in the Seattle Haven.
And even though we're not listed with any official Haven directories, her clients trust her. I'll bet they would take her recommendation, especially if she spins it as a super exclusive retreat or something.
Hey, maybe if it all goes well, we could have her put together one of those murder mystery weekends,
he teased, flashing a lazy grin. My brows shot up. You can't be serious. With our luck, we'd have a real dead body before the clock struck midnight, I grumbled. Adam chuckled. Our food arrived, and we spent the next 30 minutes brainstorming ideas in between bites. Adam was paying the check when Kira approached the table. I glanced past her and saw Cassie and Chief Lincoln leaving the pub, his arm tucked around her shoulders. Hey, Kira. Is everything all right? I asked, returning my gaze to the young woman. She nodded.
Oh, yeah, I was just wondering if I could talk to you for a few minutes about Cassie's baby shower.
Adam flipped the folio closed around a few bills and placed it on the edge of the table.
Sweeping up from his seat, he offered it to Kira.
I know lady talk when I hear it, he said, smiling. Why don't you two order some dessert? I'll see you back home, gorgeous.
He dropped a quick kiss to my forehead and then scooted off. Kira sighed, watching him go. Does he have a brother? She asked, twisting back around in her seat. I laughed and reached for my iced tea. He's one of a kind. Kira smiled as she turned her attention to the laminated dessert menu.
You're a lucky lady.
Thank you, I replied, smiling at the diamond ring on my left hand for a moment before pointing to a picture on the menu. Should we split a brownie sundae? Kira agreed, and we flagged down Merrily, one of the regular servers, to place the order. With that settled, Kira dug into her pocket and produced a folded piece of paper. As she smoothed it out, I noted the sheet was from the pad Cassie liked to keep by the phone for takeout orders. I could imagine Kira scribbling down ideas in between taking orders at the coffee shop where she worked part-time. I've never planned anything like this before, and I want it to be special for her and Jeff. I've been trying to write down some ideas, but I feel kind of, like, frozen, I guess. I know you're good at this stuff, so I was kind of hoping you could help me with the planning.
Sure. What have you got sorted out so far?
Kira frowned down at the creased paper in front of her.
Not much, to be honest. I've been a little distracted lately.
Everything okay? I asked. The young woman glanced up at me. Her expression conflicted for a moment. Then, with an exhale, she leaned heavily on the table, propped up by her elbows.
Well, actually, I could use some advice.
I set my glass of iced tea aside.
Okay.
Kira's mouth twisted as she absently fiddled with the coaster where Adam's glass had been.
It's been hard on Cassie having our dad so far away, she began. We're both happy for him and Nancy, of course, but Cass was his caretaker for so long, the transition has been hard on her. Now, with the baby on the way, she's really missing having him close.
I nodded. Cassie had frequently mentioned missing her dad since his move to Phoenix with his new wife, Nancy. I think it's been a big adjustment. Are you worried about her? Kira's lips contorted once again, and she tore the corner off the napkin and crumpled the small shred into a ball.
I'm more worried about what would happen if I were to leave, too.
My brows arched.
Oh.
Kira's eyes met mine, a near-carbon copy of her big sister's.
See, there's this photography job in Africa, and I found out last week that my application was accepted. I would have to leave right before the baby is born, and I wouldn't be back for 6 months.
I tried to suppress a grimace.
It's one of those once-in-a-lifetime things, filming a pride of lions for a major conservation documentary. I mean, it's going to be shown in theaters and everything. My name would be on the big screen.
Wow, Kira, that's incredible, I exclaimed. Congratulations! It was terrible timing, but it was a tremendous opportunity, especially for such a young photographer. Kira used to be the girl who complained about her homework, slept in till noon, and skipped all her morning classes. But that had changed when she'd taken her first photography class. She'd always enjoyed photographing things with the digital camera her father bought her, but never did much more than load photos onto social media. I'd seen some of her recent shots, now that she had some training under her belt, and saw for myself she had a distinctive eye.
So you think I should take it? The job, I mean?
Her voice wavered, the anxiety near palpable. It's not a decision I can make for you, Kira, but I don't think you need me to. I paused, offering a supportive smile. I think you already have your answer. Her cheeks warmed a rosy pink.
I guess so. But how am I supposed to tell her?
I exhaled. I didn't envy the task. When I'd stopped in to visit her a few days before, she'd been on the verge of tears while trying to decide what kind of crib to order. I think timing is everything, I told Kira. I'd say maybe wait a couple weeks. Maybe find something to bribe her with, you know, to soften the blow. Kira snorted.
Oh, sure. Hey, Cass, here's a pint of peanut butter and jelly ice cream, your favorite. Oh, and by the way, I'm moving to Africa for 6 months. Hope the whole baby thing works out for you.
Okay, maybe not quite like that, I laughed. I was thinking maybe a sister spa day or a special getaway for just the two of you. Get some quality time in. It's only 6 months. And from what I've been told, those first 6 months are mostly a sleep-deprived blur of hormones and wonder. The corner of Kira's mouth quirked up at that.
That's true.
In either case, we'll throw her the baby shower of her dreams, I added, matching Kira's smile. Chapter 3. Unfortunately, the Cold War with Pierre only lasted for about 18 hours. Following an epic coffee spill at work, I raced home at lunch to change my blouse before my meeting with Anastasia and found the disgruntled liaison sitting at the kitchen table. One of my favorite mugs sat to his left, a billow of steam pluming from it like he was shooting a Folgers commercial. "What in the other world are you doing here?" I demanded, immediately forgetting the reason I'd come into the kitchen in the first place. "And how did you get in? You don't have a key." Pierre glanced up, his expression blank, as though I'd asked him for the weather report rather than accused him of breaking and entering. His gaze hitched on my chest, and I glanced down at the gigantic splash of coffee. "Oh, right." Half an hour before, Harmony and I wound up in a head-on collision, and the better part of a large latte ended up splattered down the front of my button-up. Pierre's thin lips quirked into a smile as he raised his eyes to mine.
"I was hoping we might have a conversation, but it appears I might have caught you at an inopportune moment."
"Gee, you think?" I scoffed. Pierre turned in the chair and crossed his legs. He lifted the mug and took a slow, casual sip. Clearly, he wasn't going anywhere. Sighing, I tossed my hands up and crossed to the sink. "I don't have time for whatever this is. I have a meeting in the Seattle Haven to see about getting some customers, since you're not interested in helping us anymore."
"I never said I would not help you,"
he countered, his expression almost feline.
"I said I could not help you, at least not until you—"
"We're not putting in a bigger driveway," I snapped. "End of story. We'll call you when we have the paperwork ready, just like we all agreed to last night." Pierre set the coffee aside and laced his fingers together before settling them atop his bony knee.
"I'm afraid you have no choice. I came here to inform you that upon my conversation with the Haven Hospitality Committee, you will need to expand your parking to comply with the new policy."
"New policy?" I repeated, my voice reaching new octaves as I struggled to smother another scream.
"That's right. You see, I went to speak with the committee about your situation, and they agreed that street parking is not suitable."
My molars ground together.
"I came straight here to sort this out," Pierre continued,
smiling as if expecting some kind of reward for his helpfulness.
"As you can see, I have found the perfect spot. It's not as elaborate as my original proposal, of course, but it will meet the HHC requirements quite nicely, with only a few tiny changes to the layout."
He gestured at the paperwork on the table. As I approached, I realized one of the larger sheets of paper had a sketch of the manor's floor plan. Reluctantly, I leaned over and inspected the pencil markings on the graph paper. When I realized what he'd done, I snapped back to my full height and stared down my nose at the smug man. "Pierre, where is my greenhouse?"
"There is simply no room for it," he replied coolly. "If you refuse to extend the property's existing driveway, then this is the only place we can put overflow parking. And so much more affordable, too."
My eyes blazed as he offered a self-satisfied little smirk. He knew exactly what he was doing. He knew I would never get rid of my greenhouse and gardens, which meant we'd have to agree to his original proposal of adding a circular loop to the end of the driveway on the other side, widening it out, and adding a walkway to the front of the property. "This is a dead end with plenty of quiet on-street parking. How is that any different than a cement slab in the side yard?"
"Yes, I see," Pierre shrugged. "Unfortunately, it will not satisfy the new addendum. One parking spot is required per guest suite, except in the case of townhomes and condominiums.
My jaw tensed. A new addendum, huh? At your request, I assume?
Pierre's eyes sparkled as he gave a little shrug of his narrow shoulders.
I might have suggested it would be a wise policy to adopt, especially when considering approving properties not inside a proper haven. After all, we wouldn't want to tussle with non-magical insurance agencies any more than absolutely necessary, hmm?
What exactly is your problem with me? With us? I flung my arms out. With this place?
Me? I do not have any problems. All I am doing is enforcing the rules and policies of the HHC. That is my job,
Pierre responded, doing his best impression of a headlight-stricken deer, even as his calculating smile revealed the edges of the great white shark lurking beneath the innocent exterior. Stars, where was Posey when you needed her? Another epic ghost meltdown was likely the only thing that would get Pierre off the course he'd chosen.
I want you out, I said, my tone icy. You are a liaison, not the property manager. You have no right to come in here, uninvited, and set up camp in my kitchen. If you have further business to discuss, we can set up another meeting.
Surprise registered in his eyes. But Pierre rose smoothly from the stool and gathered his papers with grating coolness.
As you wish, Miss Bolt. I will phone you tomorrow to make the arrangements.
Swell, I quipped, crossing my arms. Pierre offered a curt nod and swept from the room. I fought the urge to follow him and make sure he actually left the house. My fingertips turned white as I gripped the counter's edge and waited to hear the front door closing. Only then did I exhale, a string of curses flying out with the whoosh of breath.
Unbelievable, I muttered, taking his abandoned coffee mug to the kitchen sink. I dumped out the contents and scrubbed it, all the while muttering under my breath. Resentment boiled over as I fumed.
Maybe we'd been naive to think we could even start an inn. The idea would have seemed crazy less than a year before. If only my 25-year-old self could see me now. I had all the things I never thought I would, and more. My potions license, a thriving apothecary, a house full of friends. I was engaged to a man I'd never seen coming, but now couldn't imagine a day without. Maybe the inn was asking too much. Maybe it would be better to cut my losses and sell the place. Someone who didn't have 1,000 emotional tendrils wrapped around every square inch of the place. Someone who could make executive decisions the way Pierre wanted. I stopped my fervent scrubbing and blew out a huff. Screw that. The inn was my home. I would not let anyone chase me away. Least of all, Pierre. We'd gotten off on the wrong foot the day he'd sashayed into the manor, doling out eviction notices. Sure, he'd been acting on the SPA's behalf, but his lack of compassion and blasé attitude never sat right with me. I rinsed the mug, deposited it into the drain board by the sink, and dried my hands on the tea towel hanging from the magnetic hook on the front of the dishwasher. Then, straightening my shoulders, I went after Pierre. I stepped out onto the front porch and heard his accented voice carry from around the corner. A large porch wrapped around most of the manor, starting at the front of the house, going around the side my greenhouse and garden beds occupied, all the way to the larger back deck off the kitchen. In the renovation process, we had made no changes to the deck, but we'd spent 2 weekends stripping off the old varnish and giving it a fresh coat of protective stain. We'd also purchased a second-hand patio set from a client of Evangeline's when the woman upgraded her own set. The set was barely broken in, and we'd gotten it for next to nothing. Adam built a fire pit, and we put up some privacy shades to complete the backyard oasis. My steps slowed as I neared Pierre. His voice was tight, his words clipped. Whoever he was speaking with, it didn't appear to be a pleasant conversation. Through slats in the privacy screen, I could see him pacing.
Marabel, I told you the money will be there soon. I am finishing a job now, and the commission should be more than enough to keep your trap shut, at least until next month.
I blinked. I'd seen several sides to Pierre Ansel over the past months. Most of them fell into categories like
egomaniacal, smarmy, and snobby. This was something else.
Is that a threat, chérie?
Pierre's voice was dripping with fierce sarcasm.
Yes, yes, send your little dog for me. I will stop at the store and buy a box of biscuits for him.
Pierre laughed, though the sound was hollow and cold. I backed up a step and flattened myself against the side of the house. Whatever was going on, I wasn't about to insert myself into the middle of it. Besides that, I had a meeting to get to. Anastasia Winters hosted me at her studio in the heart of the Seattle Haven. Everything about the office showcased Anastasia's taste. Classic and timeless, embellished without being overdone. A framed photograph of her and her fiancé, Caleb, sat prominently on the bookshelf beside a horizontally stacked pile of coffee table books.
"Please tell me you're here to finally start talking about wedding plans," Anastasia said, sweeping her skirt smooth as she sat down on the other side of the desk from me.
I smiled and crossed one leg over the other, lacing my hands together on my knee as my toes bounced softly in the air. I'd changed out of my coffee-stained top into a ruffled emerald-green blouse that always made me feel confident. The color worked well with my auburn hair and pale complexion. Whenever I was with Anastasia, I felt the need to bump up my fashion a notch or three, especially when visiting her studio. Everyone who worked for her looked like they could hop onto a catwalk and fill in for a model in case of emergency, especially Anastasia herself. I'd never been in her walk-in closet, but Harmony had confirmed my suspicion that it looked like the interior of an haute couture boutique. "You're one to talk," I replied. "You and Caleb have been engaged a lot longer than me and Adam."
"Fair enough,"
Anastasia laughed, glancing down at her own diamond engagement ring. "I guess it just feels like you and Adam have been together forever. I'm still trying to figure out just where Caleb even came from."
"What, like Mars or something?" I teased.
Anastasia grinned.
"Yes, exactly."
"Well, I hate to burst your wedding bubble, but we had to back burner the whole wedding thing," I told her. "We kind of wiped out our savings when we bought the manor."
Anastasia's face fell.
"But," I hurried on, lifting a finger, "you might be able to help us get to the wedding stuff a lot sooner." One of Anastasia's perfectly manicured brows quirked.
"I'm listening."
I quickly filled her in on the HHC requirements and kept myself from careening back into the hopeless spiral I'd just yanked myself out of back at the manor. The lingering anxiety washed away as Anastasia launched into a plan of attack. As soon as she knew the goal, she turned into a one-woman army. Within minutes, a variety of magazines and books lay spread out across her enormous desk.
"You're in a beach town, and it's summertime, so that's a no-brainer. Seaside retreats. So, we do a photo shoot with big umbrellas in the sand, fresh seafood dinners under those little twinkling patio lights. How's the surfing out there? Could we pitch it as a surfer's paradise?"
Without looking up, she flipped through a white binder, stopping at a splash of photos taken from a beach wedding.
"I did this one last year. Two surfers married on the beach where they first met."
I leaned in closer. "Is her tiara made of fairies?" Anastasia beamed.
"Yes. Aren't they just precious? They're well paid for the event, of course."
"Wow. And here I thought my hardest decision would be what neckline I wanted for my dress."
"Sweetheart, obviously,"
Anastasia said, in an offhanded way that made me think she didn't even fully realize she'd said it.
"And don't you worry about your dress. We'll have Aurelia make you something truly show-stopping. She always makes time for my brides. You like the fancy tiara, though? They can do veils, too, if you'd rather. Or both. Wouldn't that be stunning?"
I grinned. "I know what you're doing, Stacy." Anastasia blinked innocently.
"Hmm?"
Laughing, I sat back in my chair. "Next summer, I promise. For now..."
Okay, sorry."
Anastasia flipped closed a few of the books and magazines, then circled back to one showing a beautiful suite in some cottage, filled with natural light and crisp white linens. A tray of breakfast sat on the bed, a glass of orange juice providing a pop of color in the spread.
"What's the first thing you think about when looking at this picture?"
"Exhausted by the amount of work it must take to keep those sheets that clean," I quipped. Anastasia laughed.
"Fair point. But what do you feel?"
"Honestly," I said, I'd like the phone number so I could put in a reservation with my name on it, then spend a solid week napping.
Exactly.
Anastasia snapped her fingers. It looks like bliss. The manor looks great, but it's not exactly on this level, I confessed with a slight cringe. We don't have a dry cleaner living in the attic.
The point is, we need an advertising campaign like this. One that screams relaxation, rejuvenation, recharging. Your inn needs to be the go-to spot for supernaturals who need a break from the hustle and bustle of the havens, right?
I nodded. That's what we're shooting for, yeah.
Okay. So how about this? I come out with one of my photographers and we take some shots. Then I can pitch this as a rejuvenation retreat for my brides. They can purchase a weekend package for them and all of their bridesmaids to come and stay at your inn, spend their days on the beach or in Evangeline's spa, and then go out and enjoy the nightlife or do a casual thing around a bonfire. It's perfect. I blinked. Just like that, it all came together in a crystal clear image. Not only did Anastasia have access to clients, but in 15 minutes she'd branded the entire thing and offered to streamline the marketing, too.
What do you think? She asked, leveling me with a glance.
I think you're an angel.
She cackled at that and slid the books and magazines out of the way before grabbing a white folio from the corner of her desk. Smiling, she flipped it open and ran her finger down one page.
Oh, this is perfect. Tomorrow at 9:30. One of my favorite photographers has a cancellation.
She cringed and added, cold feet on the part of the groom.
Ouch.
Anastasia gave a solemn nod, then brightened once more.
Bree will be perfect for this project. It must be kismet. So do you think you can have things camera ready by then?
A flutter of nerves tried to rattle me, but I fought them back and smiled.
I can do that.
Chapter 4.
I don't know, Holly. The brides Stace works with are usually a little, well, bratty would be a polite way of putting it. Are you sure that's a good audience to tap when you're looking for glowing reviews? After leaving the meeting with Anastasia, I'd gone straight back to work at Starfire Apothecary and caught Harmony up on the day's events while we worked together in the back room.
That's true, I agreed, nodding at Harmony's raised concern. They might be a little pickier, but the way I see it, Anastasia's clients are wealthy, well-connected. When we get their glowing reviews, they might carry even more weight, seeing as how most of the people serving on the HHC board are the wealthy, well-connected types, too. A slow smile spread across Harmony's face as she tapped two fingers to her temple.
You're always thinking.
I laughed, more like I'm extremely skilled at identifying the silver lining. Harmony giggled as she stirred a draft intended to reverse hair loss.
The best part is that you did it without Pierre's help.
Can I be there when you tell him you got all the reviews? I want to watch him sputter and turn purple. That might be my favorite part, too, I replied with a wicked grin. However, we still have the parking situation to figure out, and Merlin knows what obstacles he'll throw out next. Harmony scoffed, shaking her head as she continued finessing the vats of bubbling potions.
I just don't get it. What is his deal? It's like he's getting some kind of kickback from these construction people or something. I mean, first he sent that crew of humans over to knock down walls and stuff. Even Agent Bramble thought that was weird. Now he's stuck on this driveway thing.
And the roof, I added, my wheels starting to spin a little faster. Was Harmony on to something? I leaned against the counter. I forgot to tell you the weirdest part, I started. When I was at the house, he got a call and I overheard part of it. The door between the front of the shop and the studio space flung open and a panicked Eliza appeared.
So sorry to bother you, but, can I get some help? The line is to the door and I have two people on hold.
The petite brunette was my newest hire. Sweet as pie, but still working to learn the ropes and didn't have the confidence of my two other part-timers. Straightening, I gestured at the phone. Harmony, you want to take the phone? I'll help out front. Eliza exhaled.
Oh, thank you, Holly.
Of course. I followed the young woman to the front counter and jumped into the groove of ringing up customer purchases and fielding product questions. It felt good. The shop was my literal dream come true, and when it got busy, I sometimes still had to pinch myself to believe it was all happening.
The rest of the afternoon passed in a blur of customers coming and going, each one punctuated by the familiar twinkling charm I'd set on the front door. When things wound down, I thanked Eliza for her hard work and sent her home. Harmony finished the potion work in the back while I tidied the ravaged displays and restocked as best I could, keeping a tally of low inventory as I went. "Looks like we might need to do a little brewing on Saturday," I called from the front. "If you're free, that is." Harmony came out from the back room. Her apron was splattered with a myriad of stains, showing a variety of colors and textures. Her electric blue bangs were swept to one side, the rest of her shoulder-length hair tucked into a messy bun at the back of her head. "I'm free in the afternoon. I have a thing in the morning." I quirked a brow, smiling at the way she'd hesitated. "A thing?" Harmony rolled her eyes. "It's a coffee thing." My smile grew. "Uh-huh. With a boy, perhaps?" "He's 34, so I'd say man, but yes. It's a date kind of thing, okay?" I giggled at her exasperation. Harmony had turned into something of a cynic in regards to dating. She had every right to be, after a couple bad breakups in the past. Sometimes she put on a show, teasing Adam and me for being lovey-dovey, but I knew it was a shield. Harmony wanted love, just like most people. But she was still young, and I wasn't sure she knew exactly what it was she was looking for in a partner. Evangeline and I had spent more than a few afternoon teas bemoaning Harmony's bad boy radar. 34, huh? I said, holding back the urge to ask how many tattoos, piercings, and motorcycles her date possessed. Not that those things automatically made a bad boy, but they tended to be red flags when it came to Harmony's track record. "Yes, Mom," Harmony replied, fighting a smile. "I swear, I'm not sure which one of you is the fussiest, you, Evangeline, or Adam." "Definitely Adam," I replied with a laugh. "I had to threaten him with a balding hex to keep him from going after that guy who stood you up last month." "Jesse," Harmony sighed. "I would have given him the address." I laughed. "Yeah, well, I don't have bail money, so it was probably for the best he stayed home." It was supposed to be the couple's fourth date, but Harmony came home on the verge of tears after finding her date at the bar next door, making out with another woman, having completely forgotten about the date with Harmony. "Jesse was a major jerk face," Harmony sniffed. "Henry isn't like that. He's nice." "Where did you meet?" I asked, moving to the next section of shelves to continue cataloging the remaining stock. "The library, actually," she replied, hopping up onto the refurbished buffet that served as our front counter. "He's a teacher at the elementary school on Sunflower Lane." I stopped, vial in hand, and glanced up at her. "Wait, he's from Beechwood?" Harmony nodded. "Is he human?" Harmony interjected. "Yes, or at least I think so." I swallowed. The last thing I wanted to do was stomp all over her plans, but dating a human could go sideways in a hurry. "I already know what you're going to say," Harmony continued. "It's just coffee, so let's not get too carried away, okay?" I opened my mouth, then shut it, offering a slight nod instead. "All right. Thank you." Harmony hopped down. "I've got to bottle up that last batch, then I can help with inventory if you want." I considered the shelf in front of me. "I'm just about done. You finish up in the back, then we'll get out of here. It's been a long day. I'm ready for some dinner and a TV binge fest." "Can't argue with that," Harmony called as she ducked into the back room. In the busyness of the day, I'd all but forgotten about Teddy's arrival to the manor. When Harmony and I made it back home, we found the lovebirds canoodling on the couch. They jumped apart at the sound of the front door, and I couldn't help but laugh at the looks on their faces. "Guys, this isn't high school, and I'm most definitely not your mom." "Nope, she's my mom," Harmony teased, bumping me playfully with her elbow as she swept into the living room. Evangeline shot Teddy a look as she adjusted her top. "Hi, Teddy," I said, offering a wave. "Glad you made it safely." "Hello, Holly. Harmony?" He waved back. Harmony kicked out of her shoes and dumped her purse on one hook lining the wall beside the front door. "You two going out for dinner?" "Actually, I'm cooking," Evangeline said. Harmony and I both froze, then slowly turned to look at our friend. Evangeline was a skilled witch, but in the kitchen, not even magic could save her. You're cooking? I asked.
I got one of those meal delivery things, Evangeline replied. All the ingredients came in this big box, and there are instruction cards for every step. It practically cooks itself.
Right. Did you want some help anyway? Harmony asked. The lilt in her voice said she was on the same wavelength as me, envisioning the brand new stove engulfed in flames. Before Evangeline could answer, the front door swung open again and Adam strode into the house.
We having some kind of house meeting? He asked,
grinning as he lifted the large messenger bag off his chest and set it on the floor where it could lean against the wall.
Hey, Teddy, how's it going?
I'm well, thank you. You still working on getting the Havens into the 21st century?
Teddy asked with a knowing grin. Adam grunted and gestured at the bag that housed his laptop and other tech equipment.
Yup. I never thought something could make me wistfully look back on my days in a customer service call center. And yet...
He trailed off, then shrugged.
Here we are.
Teddy chuckled.
Well, from someone who lives and works in a haven, thank you. I honestly don't understand the hesitation after all these years. Embracing technology will only enhance the magical world, not take something away from it.
Appreciate it, Adam replied with a quick nod.
So, what's for dinner? You just getting home too, gorgeous?
I smiled. Well, Evangeline has plans for her and Teddy.
Oh, there's enough for everyone, Evangeline hurried to interject. I ordered the box for large families. Seemed appropriate.
Adam shot me a look.
Box?
Evangeline is cooking, I clarified,
fighting back a smile. Adam's thick brows lifted.
Oh? Well, that's great.
Turning to Evangeline, he smiled.
You know, we don't want to horn in on your date night. So, you know, maybe we should go out? McNally's has the seafood special tonight.
No, Evangeline exclaimed, hopping up from the couch. I've got it all under control.
I'll help, Harmony said, scampering after her. Teddy smiled and followed the ladies into the kitchen. Adam leaned in closer and lowered his voice.
When was the last time we checked the levels on the fire extinguisher?
With Harmony running interference, dinner made it to the table on time. It was a win-win. Evangeline got to have the satisfaction of having cooked, and the rest of us got to eat without first having to battle a grease fire. We sat down to eat in the formal dining room and passed plates around, catching up with Teddy since the last time we'd seen him at the bubble potion competition. Harmony and I had competed in the competition. He'd been there as a guest to one of the other apprentices, his ex-girlfriend Erin. He told us about his law practice, then he and Adam talked tech. We told him about our plans for the inn, including the drama with Pierre and the HHC. Teddy perked up at the name.
Pierre Ansel? He said.
You know him? I asked. Teddy wiped his mouth with a napkin.
Unfortunately, yes, he answered with a slight chuckle. I squared off against him in court a few years ago. I had a client who was looking to get into the hospitality business down in the San Diego Haven. Pierre needed to give the rubber stamp of approval, but he and my client didn't see eye to eye on much of anything, and things devolved rather quickly.
Sounds familiar, I bemoaned.
Did you win the case?
Adam asked, his fork hovering a few inches above his plate. Teddy's smile grew.
Why do you think he's working up here in Washington now?
Adam chuckled and raised his beer bottle in a silent toast to the lawyer.
I can't take all the credit, of course, Teddy continued. Ours wasn't the only case against the man. He had quite a complaint file.
Why does the Haven still use him at all? I asked. I mean, isn't there some kind of license they could revoke?
You know how the council operates, Holly. They speak two languages, money and power. Ansel trades money for his power. He's greased the right palms. My guess is they moved him from California up here to make it look like they took the complaints seriously.
I rolled my eyes.
Great.
So there's little to no hope of us getting rid of him. We have exactly $0.
Teddy offered a sympathetic smile.
Well, if things get sticky, maybe I can help. We have a history, and he knows he can't push me around. Has he issued any threats?
I sighed and leaned back. Not belligerently or anything. Mostly a lot of preening and lording his power over us to make us do what he wants. Sometimes it's stupid stuff, like making us rearrange furniture or nagging us about the landscaping. But there have been bigger things, too. A few months ago, before Adam and I took over, he hired a crew of humans to come do construction and didn't notify any of us so we could be careful, you know, with magic and such. Our landlady Posey threw a fit and nearly leveled the place. Agent Bramble had to come in and set things right. The whole situation was a disaster. Teddy grimaced.
According to him, anything less than 500 thread count is simply barbaric,
Adam added. Adam thinks he can do a French accent, I interjected in a stage whisper behind my hand. We're choosing to roll with it.
Hey,
Adam complained. Teddy chuckled and looped an arm around Evangeline's shoulders. She relaxed against him with a serene smile.
Oh, and remember he says all the guest suites need soaker tubs, Adam said.
I groaned, having temporarily forgotten that particular debate.
Right.
You don't even want to know how much the estimate was for that little swapperoo. I mean, he talks about this stuff like it's all just a finger's snap away from being reality. He doesn't care that we have a budget. He hates the linens, the dishes, and he really hates continental breakfasts.
Madness, Adam said, his face bewildered. I mean, how can you hate endless muffins and those little boxes of cereal?
I don't know what he's cranky about, Evangeline piped up. The place looks better than ever. And it's not like it was some kind of cesspool before the renovations. Anyone would be lucky to get a reservation here.
I have to agree, Teddy added. The place looks great.
Thank you, I smiled at them. Right now, the sticking point is the parking situation. He wants us to tear out half of the front yard to expand the driveway. Either that or demolish my greenhouse and gardens to put in an overflow slab. I'm not thrilled with either idea, but it's all kind of moot considering we can't afford to take on that kind of project, even if I agreed with it.
I don't have a ton of advice for you, Teddy said. Ride it out. Eventually, he will get bored and get assigned to his next project. In my research for the case I had, it seemed that was his custom. And hey, if you want to sue for damages down the line, give me a call. I'd love another excuse to come up and visit.
He smiled at Evangeline as she lounged against him. Thank you, Teddy. We really appreciate it. I pushed up from my chair, taking my plate with me. Why don't you two let us take care of the dishes? Go down to the beach and catch the sunset.
Are you sure?
Evangeline said. I smiled at her. Of course. We're innkeepers now. This is what we do. Teddy chuckled as he got to his feet, drawing Evangeline up beside him.
I was already going to give you a 5-star review, but I won't object.
Chapter 5.
You think we should sue him?
Adam asked, as we went about our bedtime routine a few hours later. I exhaled. The question had been pinging around my mind ever since Teddy brought it up at dinner. I don't know, I replied. I don't think we have much of a case at the moment. But maybe dropping Teddy's name and a few threats of our own wouldn't be the worst idea. He needs to know that we won't be his punching bags anymore. We all need to get our heads together, get the inn open, and move on.
That's what we've been trying to do for the last 6 weeks,
Adam countered, reaching for the toothpaste. I scrubbed at my face a little harder than necessary. Anastasia is coming tomorrow morning with a photographer. If things work out the way they're supposed to, we'll have the review cards in the next few months and Pierre will lose his power over us. Maybe we can hire Teddy to speak with someone directly at the HHC about the parking situation? Adam shrugged one shoulder, still brushing his teeth.
Worth a shot.
I scooted Adam out of the way and rinsed my face with warm water. We'd expanded the bathroom during the renovations, but there was still only one sink for us to share. After several months of cohabitating, we had the evening ritual of getting ready for bed down to a choreographed rhythm, each shuffling and swerving past the other. It was one of the small habits that I'd grown to appreciate about our new living situation. Adam handed me a towel, and I pressed it against my cheeks. Thanks. After depositing the towel on the counter, I padded into the bedroom and sat down beside a lounging Boots at the foot of the bed. Adam finished up and hit the bathroom lights.
If Anastasia's plan works, we could probably raise the funds to expand the driveway.
Maybe, but that's just getting us deeper in the hole. I want to pay back your parents as soon as possible. Adam chuckled.
I get that, but to be fair to them, they know it might take us a while. They haven't asked about it the last couple of times we've spoken.
Maybe I was being petulant. We'd had to borrow a large sum of money from Adam's parents to qualify for the loan we'd taken to buy the manor. We had enough to cover the monthly mortgage payments, thanks largely to Evangeline and Harmony's rent money, but we weren't close to making a dent in the loan from Adam's parents. Even if they weren't desperate to get it back, which they weren't, I still wanted the debt cleared. Adam's parents weren't thrilled with his life choices in general. They didn't understand why he'd rejected his hometown in the Boston Haven, moving across the country to start a small tech business out of a bedroom in a house that sometimes served as a halfway house for troubled paranormals. And they really didn't understand when he suddenly started dating one of those so-called troubled. This was all made worse thanks to a little scene I'd made upon meeting them for the first time as I was being dragged out of the house in a pair of SPA handcuffs. Adam claimed they'd come to terms with things and were supportive of our recent engagement. But I held my own reservations. They still hadn't returned to Beechwood Harbor for a follow-up visit. Not that we'd been in a huge hurry to invite them. I suppose I shouldn't be so critical. After all, they had agreed to lend us the money to buy the Beechwood Manor, knowing that it meant extinguishing their last flicker of hope that Adam would ever return to Boston.
They did ask about the wedding, Adam said, sinking down on the other side of the orange tabby cat. Wondering if we'd decided on a date yet.
What did you tell them? I asked, absently scratching the underside of Boots's chin.
The truth, Adam replied. That we're paying for it ourselves and right now we just don't have the funds.
I could feel there was more to the conversation. Adam was hesitating, focusing on stroking Boots. Recognition dawned and I frowned. They offered to pay for it, didn't they? Adam glanced up.
Would that really be such a terrible thing?
Adam, I hardly know your parents. It would feel weird to take such a huge chunk of money from them. Besides, it's one of those things that always comes with strings attached. They'd want to know what we were planning and why. Your mom is probably some kind of event planning goddess. We want a simple service with a casual reception. It's not going to live up to what she probably has in mind for her only son's wedding day. Adam arched a brow.
Does Anastasia know this? I think you're going to have a harder time reining her in than you would with my mother.
I smiled.
Touché. They just want to see us happy, Holly. I promise. If we take their offer, it's not like they'll move in for a month and be looking over our shoulders as we make the reservations and bookings.
I sighed and flopped onto my back. Boots made a disgruntled noise as the chin scratches came to an abrupt stop. I guess. So what, they'd just write us a blank check? Adam chuckled.
I'm sure there would be a ceiling. But yeah, we could make our plans and pay for what we can and let them pick up the rest. Honestly, I get the feeling they would almost be offended if we didn't let them help, at least in some way.
I turned my head and looked up at him. What do you think we should do? Adam twisted and laid down on his side, his head propped up against his hand as he lounged. Boots stood up, turned in a circle, and swished his bottle brush tail, giving us a prolonged view of his backside before lying down again. Adam smiled at the grumpy feline, then met my gaze once more.
What do I think? Well, I think I want to marry the woman of my dreams, and that if accepting a gift from my parents makes that happen sooner, I'm okay with it.
A flutter of excitement and nerves swooped through my stomach. Can I think about it? Adam nodded.
Sure. They didn't give me an expiration date.
Okay. I smiled. For now, I need to get some sleep. Anastasia is coming at 9:30, so I'm going to have to get up before the birds if I have any hope of getting this place ready for its close-up. Adam dropped a kiss to my lips and then pulled back.
I think I'll go out for a run.
A run? I frowned. He sat up.
I'm not really tired. It's been a few weeks since my last one, and I can feel it.
As a shifter, when Adam said, go for a run, it was a code. He wasn't planning to slip on a pair of sneakers and hit the pavement. He needed to shift into his beast form, a large breed dog, and run through the woods behind the manor, indulging his beast's senses to release the energy that often built up in his system when he went too long between shifts. I guess it has been a while, I said, scooting up to the head of the bed to stick my legs beneath the covers. The summers were generally warm in Beechwood Harbor, but the nighttime temperatures could swing 20 to 30 degrees cooler than the day, and it wasn't uncommon to go to bed wearing an extra layer, even in June and July. All right, well, be safe. Do you want me to wait up? Adam stood.
You just said you have to wake up early tomorrow. I won't be long. I'll try to get back and get some sleep so I can be up to help you in the morning.
I smiled. I'm picking up muffins from the bakery. If you're not awake by the time I get back with them, I'll just wave one under your nose and rouse you back to consciousness.
That should do the trick.
Adam laughed as he headed for the door. He paused, his hand on the knob, and turned back.
Good night, gorgeous. I love you.
Love you too. When I woke the following morning, Adam's place in the bed beside me was empty. Frowning, I gathered my thoughts. The bathroom door was open, the interior darkened. Had Adam not come home last night following his run through the woods? It wasn't unheard of for him to run until the wee hours of the morning, but I couldn't remember him staying out all night before. I dressed in a pair of leggings and a tank top, throwing a lightweight sweater over the top to fight off the morning chill. Boots followed me downstairs, and I fed him while I waited for the coffee to brew. As he noshed on the revolting-smelling pile of mushed chicken, I searched the first floor for signs of Adam. His laptop was in the living room, but it didn't look like it had been moved from where he'd set it down the night before. So he hadn't been up late working. I didn't have all morning to look for him, so I shoved aside my concern and dove into cleaning the manor. I spent hours dusting every surface, polishing the wood floors until they gleamed, and gave the kitchen and bathrooms a once-over. I fluffed the pillows on the couches in the formal living room, set out a centerpiece in the dining room that I'd purchased from Scarlett's flower shop the night before. I put more floral arrangements in each of the guest suites before turning down the covers. I set out fresh linens and drew the blinds and curtains. The final result wasn't quite as perfect as the magazine spreads Anastasia had shown me, but it was as close as I was going to get. The photographer would have to work their magic to get it the rest of the way to the finish line. Evangeline and Teddy came downstairs as I was arranging decorative birch logs in the fireplace. Evangeline insisted on helping me get the house ready for the photo shoot, so I gave her a short list of tasks before I made a run to the bakery to buy some pastries and bread to use as props in the kitchen. I wanted the cozy bed and breakfast factor to radiate off the pages of the photo spread. I expected Adam to materialize in the kitchen as I transferred a dozen blueberry muffins onto a decorative tray. The door swung open, and I smiled, turning, only to find Teddy. He'd showered and dressed. I almost did a double take, having never seen him in something as casual as a pair of jeans and a flannel shirt.
Oh, I thought Evangeline was in here.
I thumbed toward the back door. She just went out to clean the window panes on the greenhouse, in case the photographer wants to get a couple shots of the garden area. Muffin? I asked, holding one up. Teddy shook his head.
I'm not much of a breakfast person. I was planning to go grab a couple of lattes. Can you tell Evangeline?
Sure. I nodded and nestled the muffin back onto the tray.
Thanks.
Teddy headed out and I went back to my arrangements. My nerves bunched together a little more with each passing moment. When there was nothing left to do, I stood at the stove, chewing on my lower lip as I watched the clock hanging above the door. Adam still wasn't back yet. Anastasia would arrive in a handful of minutes. I didn't have time to go stumbling through the woods looking for him. But if he was hurt... Boots swirled around my ankles.
Bootsy, I asked, would you go look for Adam?
The cat looked up and blinked, his amber eyes sending a silent message. Boots was my familiar. We shared a bond that went deeper than most pet-to-human relationships. If I sent Boots out on a mission, he'd make sure it got done. "Thank you," I said, crossing the kitchen to open the back door for him. As soon as I pulled the door open, a scream broke through the otherwise quiet morning, sending my heart spiked into my throat. Boots charged ahead, his tail high. I followed after him, my shoulders tensed. Evangeline came racing around the corner into view. I stopped short of the back stairs. "What is it?" The witch lifted one shaky hand, gesturing back in the direction she'd just come from. It was clear from the look on her face this was something more serious than the discovery of a fat garden spider while working in the greenhouse.
"Holly, he's dead,"
Evangeline sputtered, still pointing, her hand trembling all the more.
I tried to help him, but there's all this blood and he wouldn't respond, and I..."
My veins turned to ice, and my heart, frozen with fear, took a free fall into the pit of my stomach. "Adam." "No," I said, my voice wavering. I shook my head. "No." Black spots swam at the corners of my eyes, and the wooded backdrop started to swirl, the trees melting into a blur of colors.
"Holly, he's gone."
"No," I whispered, my entire body quivering.
"No, he can't be. We have to call the SPA,
Evangeline said, seeming to collect herself as she came closer.
"We have to call Bramble."
"No," I said, lurching forward. My legs seemed to move of their own volition as I stumbled down the handful of steps. I clutched for the railing as my muscles dissolved into jelly.
"What was he even doing out here?" I asked. "Why was he gone all night?"
"Holly," Evangeline said, her voice quiet. A sob racked my body.
"Adam!
Adam!" Evangeline shouted. The sound of his name rattled through my head, and it took me a moment to realize Evangeline was running. Turning, I tracked her, and then gasped. The remaining shreds of my heart all seized as a tall figure appeared from between the trees.
"Hey, Evie."
"Adam!" I all but screamed. He was shirtless, but wearing the same pair of sweatpants he'd had on the night before. His dark hair was wet, strands stuck to his forehead. His affable smile went limp as I started toward him.
"Holly, what's wrong? Are you crying?"
He hurried toward me as I stood immobilized.
What are you? You're not, but I thought..."
Reeling around, my mouth continued to move, though no words bubbled forth. Evangeline, realizing the mistake, gasped, one hand flying to cover her mouth.
"Oh, Holly, you thought I meant Adam?"
She swore under her breath.
"I'm so sorry. I didn't mean..."
"What's going on?"
Adam asked, coming to stand beside me. He rested a hand on my shoulder, his brown eyes boring down, filled with concern.
"Holly?"
Evangeline pointed.
"It's Pierre. Pierre is dead."
Chapter 6. Pierre Ansel was, in fact, dead, lying face down on the ground between two of the raised beds I'd constructed outside my glass greenhouse. A pair of garden shears lay a few feet away in the grass, their blades coated in blood. Three wounds were obvious on his back, showing where the shears had torn through his maroon suit jacket. The how, the cause of death, was obvious.
But the when and why and who were giant question marks swirling through my mind as I took it all in.
"What was he even doing here?"
I said, unable to tear my eyes away from Pierre's body. Adam squatted down and tried to move Pierre's arm. The elbow was bent at a strange angle, possibly broken or dislocated, as though he'd landed on it weirdly when he'd fallen.
"He's stiff. Rigor mortis. I'm not quite the CSI junkie that I used to be, but I think it means he's been out here a while. 6 hours at least, I think."
He rocked back onto his heels, still squatting, and considered the body for a long moment. Then he turned his head and looked up at us.
"I left for my run around 10:30. I didn't see, hear, or smell anyone out here."
I didn't see him either," Evangeline stammered. "When Teddy and I got back from dinner, there weren't any cars in the driveway or on the street. What could he have been doing out here?"
"Where is Teddy?"
Adam asked. "He went to get lattes," I answered. "He left a few minutes ago."
"I didn't even notice at first,"
Evangeline said, unable to tear her eyes away from Pierre's lifeless body.
"I was inside, cleaning the windows and dusting off the workbench and sweeping. Then I came out to tidy up some stray pots, and that's when..."
Her voice broke off, and I wrapped an arm around her shoulders. Adam pushed up to his feet.
"Is Agent Bramble on the way?"
"I haven't called yet."
Adam cast a glance toward the street.
"Think the neighbors could see anything?"
I considered it and then shook my head. "Doubt it, but I'm sure Bramble will have her agents go around asking." Adam's mouth formed a hard line.
"And then everyone in town will talk about another murder, and Chief Lincoln will wonder why he doesn't know a thing about it."
I froze. The thought hadn't even occurred to me, but Adam was right. Chief Lincoln was the top of the law enforcement food chain in Beechwood Harbor. Normally, such a small town wouldn't have much for him to do. Sure, at the peak of tourist season, there were a handful of drunken disorderlies, some petty theft, the occasional domestic dispute. But with such a small population, things should be fairly containable. Unfortunately, in the years I'd lived here, there had been far more attacks than statistics allowed for, most of which involved the supernatural community, at least in part. The Supernatural Protection Agency, or the SPA, handled crimes involving the supernatural world both inside and outside of the Haven communities. When crimes happened in one of the Havens, it was relatively easy for the SPA to contain the situation. But when crimes involved humans, especially when humans were the victims of the crime, things got a lot messier. This past spring, we'd had a rogue vampire show up in town, and when a man was found dead with fang marks on his neck, the SPA stepped in and took over the case. As it turned out, we had a lunatic succubus on the loose, turning a singles event into her own personal lust brunch buffet. In any case, Chief Lincoln hadn't taken it well when the SPA, posing as the FBI, swooped in and took him and his force off the investigation. In the fallout, I'd learned Chief Lincoln was seeing a lot more than the SPA wanted him to and had been keeping records on all the strange cases that randomly went missing or scooped out from under local law enforcement all along the Washington coast. What would happen when Chief...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.